Xenadeo, and then we will continue with the video and other things. Okay. So before to that, if I have to explain Xenadeo, I should continue a bit from where we left in the morning. Right? We just talked about semiconductors, but all of a sudden I cannot jump to diode. So let me share the screen now. Send you a window. Cool, share. Loading now. Okay, you can see?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh,
Yes,
fine.
ma'am.
Yeah, fine. Okay, so last class we said we talked about different types of semiconductors, different kinds of solids. When you classify based on the band diagram or based on how conductivity occurs in that, right? So that was classified into conductor, semiconductor, insulator, and we are going to now talk a bit in detail about semiconductors. So now semiconductors, in a pure form, we call as an intrinsic semiconductor. So silicon in its pure form is an intrinsic semiconductor. Another one is germanium. Okay. So if I consider the structure of silicon, so this is a silicon semiconductor where there are lots of silicon atoms. Okay. And you can see the four dots. So suppose I take this silicon here, you can see the four dots which are around it. That is the four valence electrons from this atom. So these four valence electrons, they will form four bonds, covalent bonding with the
Ma'am,
next
your voice is
valence
not audible.
electrons. Now you can hear?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So the four valence electrons from one silicon atom will form four covalent bonding with the nearby silicon atom. Okay. Now, what happens after that? Zero Kelvin, as we said earlier, zero Kelvin, it just remains as it is. The valence electron remain in the bond, right? They act as insulator. Semiconductor is an insulator. There is no conduction happening. But if I increase the temperature, what can happen? An electron, say suppose this point, an electron will gain energy from whatever temperature applied, and they will come out of the bond, they will break the bond and become a free electron. That is when they go to the conduction band, right? When they have gone, when an electron leaves this position, it leaves a vacancy or an empty space, which you call as hole. Okay, it's a hole. So, one electron went off, it produced one electron, one valence electron became a free electron, and you got it as a hole. You got one hole. But whenever there is a vacancy, obviously you see a vacancy anywhere, somebody tries to fill it in, right? So this vacancy is there, so maybe this electron below, that will break the bond and come and fill this vacancy. The hole is being replaced by an electron. So what happened? It produced new hole here. So what did we do? We removed one electron first, that produced a hole. Another electron went off, that produced a new hole. So that means electrons were going in one direction, electrons were going out in one direction, holes were being produced in the exactly opposite direction. So you will end up having lots of holes in the valence band, and you will get lots of free electrons in the conduction band. So conduction band is always, electrons are always free, so you will say it as free electron. Okay? Now, what happens if I connect a potential across an semiconductor, intrinsic semiconductor? So we talked about this already. See, electron is now, so everywhere this circus is happening. Electron is leaving, hole is being produced. That space is being filled up by an electron, then like that, another hole is being produced. So what is happening basically? Electrons are moving in one direction, holes are moving in the opposite direction. Holes are being produced in the opposite direction. Now in this figure, why is the electron moving towards this direction? Because why is it going towards the left? Because there is a positive supply which is given here, right? There is a positive supply. So electrons will be attracted towards the positive part of the semiconductor or wherever you are given the positive supply. And holes, as we said, an electron goes out and it produces a hole. So an electron has negative charge, so hole will have positive charge. So hole means absence of electron, the vacancy or absence of electron. So holes will have positive charges. So electrons have negative charges, they will move towards positive terminal. Holes will have positive charges, they will move towards the negative terminal. So this is the case of an intrinsic semiconductor. So in an intrinsic semiconductor, the total current is due to electrons and holes. That means the flow of electrons, you can see this flow of electrons, this arrow. The flow of electrons produces electron current. The flow of holes in the opposite direction produces hole current, H-O-L-E, hole current. Okay, electron current, hole current. So total current produced in an intrinsic semiconductor is the sum of electron current and hole current. Okay, now this is a pure semiconductor, or silicon in its pure form. It's an intrinsic semiconductor. What if I add some other material into it and I make it impure? The process of adding an impurity or something addition, you add something and make a pure semiconductor into impure, that process is known as doping. Right? Doping. Now, when you dope, two things can happen. Okay? So let's go. Okay, here is, you can see. So, no, better here. You have a silicon atom which has four valence electrons in ideal case, right? Suppose I add a material, I'm going to dope it with an impurity, okay? And that impurity has five valence electrons outside. There are five valence electrons, okay? So then what will happen? I will call it as a pentavalent impurity. Pentavalent impurity, that means it has five valence electrons. Okay, now if I come back to this bond diagram, instead of silicon, if I put this pentavalent impurity, for an example, phosphorus. Phosphorus is the easiest one to remember. Okay, if I put phosphorus here, what will happen? Four valence electrons with silicon will form a covalent bond with four valence electrons from phosphorus. But phosphorus ideally had five valence electrons, right? Only four of them could form the bond. Where the fifth one will go? Where the fifth one will go? Can you think?
It can be
free electron.
It can be a free electron.
Yes, it will be a free electron, right? It will be a free electron and it can stay anywhere. Correct? It can stay. It is a free electron. It can stay anywhere here within the gap. Correct? So what will happen if I add, instead of one phosphorus, okay, instead of one phosphorus atom, I add many. Many phosphorus atoms. How many free electrons can I get?
The number of phosphorus atoms.
Correct, like, exactly.
How many phosphorus atoms?
Yes, exactly. The more I add phosphorus, the more I add the pentavalent impurity, the more number of free electrons are being produced. So now, you know that free electrons exist in conduction band, right? So all these new free electrons which are now given by phosphorus or the pentavalent impurity, they all will go over, they will go to the conduction band. The moment I say if something is a valence electron, then it is in valence band. If it is something is a hole, then it is in valence band. If something is a free electron, that obviously means it is there in the conduction band. If it is free to move, then it is conducting, so it is in the conduction band. So all the free electrons will be here. So all the addition free electrons will be here. So now, the reason I didn't put a bond diagram for this case is this, because that bond diagram with the phosphorus you have already studied. What you don't know is this band diagram, with the band energy band diagram, if I have, say I have a valence band, I have a conduction band, how will I represent n-type semiconductor? Why am I calling it n-type? Because I get more number of free electrons. That means all electrons have negative charges. It is more of negative charge. So it's called as n-type semiconductor. Okay. Now, in the band diagram, you will see one difference. Wherever this phosphorus, so basically phosphorus atom, when you add, it is going to give you extra free electrons, right? So the moment you add it, those free electrons, the fifth electrons, should be able to easily reach the conduction band. So for that reason, you will have the energy level of phosphorus closer to the conduction band. This is very important. Okay. Ideal case, you didn't have anything. If it was only silicon, you didn't have anything. It was empty. It was just a band gap. We call it as a band gap. But now you are adding an impurity, something like phosphorus, which has extra valence electrons, which end up becoming free electrons. If they have to be free electrons, or that means to conduct electricity, when you add phosphorus, their energy level should be close to the conduction band, because it will be easier for them to go from this energy level to the conduction band. Okay, so phosphorus energy level will remain here. Now basically phosphorus is giving an extra electron, right, compared to the ideal intrinsic case, pure semiconductor case, where it is giving extra electron now when you add phosphorus. So for that reason, it is, we can say that it is donating electron. It is donating electron. So we call phosphorus as a donor or donor atom, donor material. Okay, donor, you're donating it. Okay, now this is the case when I added a pentavalent impurity, that means something which had excess valence electron. Okay, now what if I add something which has less valence electron? That means instead of 5, it will have less, 3 electrons.
It creates hole, ma'am.
It will create
valence. There will be a hole.
It will create hole, right? So can one of you tell me, based on this diagram, like how I told for phosphorus, let's take boron as an example. Boron is the easiest to remember. How can we do it? How can I tell it? I replace the silicon with boron. There is one bonding here, there is one bonding here, there is one bonding here, right? Three bonds happen because there are three valence electrons. But silicon has one valence electron, but boron doesn't have valence electrons. What happens here? This will be fully, this circle which I am showing will be fully empty, right? That space will be empty. This literally doesn't exist if I add boron, right? So this bond is incomplete. You cannot have an incomplete bond. So for that reason, what has to happen? The bond has to be complete, means, yeah, what should happen?
It should accept, ma'am.
What it should accept?
Another electron should occupy that.
Another electron.
Exactly. Another electron from one of the other bonds will break, come and occupy this empty portion. Right? Now what happened? Your electron came, but it left an empty space from wherever it came. From point A, it came to point B. So point B has been now, point B is now with the electron. But point A, it has left a vacancy or hole. So what happens? The process continues. Again, that hole, some electron will come and again it will produce a hole. So when you add boron or something which has only 3 electrons in the valence orbit, some atom which has only 3 electrons in the valence orbit, you will end up creating lots of holes. And as we said, holes have positive charge, right? Hole means absence of electron, opposite of negative charge, so it is positive charge. So you will call it as a p-type semiconductor. A p-type semiconductor. Okay. Now I have shown you this diagram for n-type semiconductor because we were adding extra free electrons. We have kept this line energy level close to the conduction band. I don't want to put the slide for next deliberately because I want you to answer. If I have to draw a band diagram for p-type semiconductor, where more holes are being produced, where should the energy level be of boron?
In the valence band.
In the valence band.
In the valence band?
Near to the valence band,
right? Near to the valence band or closer to the valence band. Right. It will be closer to the valence band. Okay. Now, you said earlier it has to accept it. What it ended up doing is silicon accepted, sorry, boron accepted one electron. The, for to form the bond, it had to accept another electron from silicon, right? So you call this as an acceptor atom. Boron will be an acceptor atom, or this energy level is acceptor energy level. Okay, acceptor energy level. For the other one, it is donating extra electron, so it is donor energy level. This is acceptor energy level. So both, now this is, I will call it as a p-type semiconductor because it has more of holes which have positive charges. So now both p-type and n-type we call together as one. What? Individually, n-type semiconductor, p-type semiconductor, you will call them as extrinsic semiconductor.
Extrinsic semiconductor.
Right. So now let's just revise what we did from the morning. We took one atom, then from one atom we went in having multiple atoms. We formed all the energy bands, right? And based on the energy bands, we did the classification, conductors, semiconductors, insulator. Semiconductor in a pure form is an intrinsic semiconductor. When you add the impurity, with a, if you have a pentavalent impurity, that means with something which has 5 valence electrons, you will end up getting n-type semiconductor. If you add a trivalent impurity, that means something which has 3 valence electrons, you will get a p-type semiconductor. Now, these n-type and p-type semiconductors are in general known as extrinsic semiconductors. Extrinsic because something is coming from outside. Right? Those extra electrons and holes came from outside. Okay, cool. Now, we have learned about the semiconductors. I'll just stop this slide for a second. I'll come back with another file. Okay, let me open. Where it is. Okay, now back to me. Slowly again. Okay, cool. You can see this?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am. One second. Now?
Yes, ma'am.
Cool. Fine. System slowed down. Either internet goes or system slowed down. Okay, now what if I take a p-type semiconductor and an n-type semiconductor and I bring them together? Okay? Now, what do we have in p-type semiconductor? We have lots of holes, right? But those are the, we will call them as charge carriers. Holes are the charge carriers in p-type. Electrons are the charge carriers in n-type, right? So now let's come to this next figure. If I have, so all these black circles which I have shown you, the field circles are the electrons. These empty ones will be what? If this is an electron, next to it will be?
Holes.
Ions.
Which ion?
Silicon ion.
Which silicon ion? What type?
N-type. Positively charged.
Correct. Exactly. This is a positive silicon ion along with an electron. Now, what happens on the other side? If this is a hole which has a positive charge, then the ion is
negatively charged.
Negative ion with a hole, right? Now, if I join them together by some method, okay, what do I get? It ends up all these fellows will come together, whichever are nearby, they will come together, right? They will come together. Right? And electrons and holes, so they are like exactly opposite charge. One is, electron is negative, holes are positive charge, right? So electrons and holes, these fellows will recombine. They will recombine. So what happens? They are now not there. The electrons and holes will recombine. They no more exist. Okay. Voice is stucking. Are you saying I suck or stuck? Sana, you can hear my voice. Others can hear.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. We can hear.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So the electrons and holes combine together, right? They no more now exist. So what happened? I will end up getting something like this. A region where I have only now, in between I have a region where only ions are existing. The positive and the negative ions are existing. Okay. Now let me just tell you. Before, I know you know all the terms and all those things, but I want to tell you what has happened actually. Before this thing happened, with every ion, there was an existing charge carrier, be it hole or electron, right? With every ion, there was a charge carrier, electron or hole, something was there. But when they recombined here at the in-between region, now the ions don't have these electrons and holes with them, right? So it was like they were like a couple in the beginning, and those fellows ditched and they have now become single, right? The ions are left, they have been left, they are very alone. The charge carriers went out, right? So in another way, you can read this, ions are ripped off or depleted of the charge carriers. Ions are ripped or depleted of the charge carriers, of the charges. There are no more associated. That is the reason this region where there are no charge carriers and only ions are present, you will call as a depletion region. A depletion region. Okay. Now, before I go to the next slide, I think my system is hung. For a second, I'll stop sharing and come back. Can see it's loading. One second. Yeah, now you can see, correct? Yes. Cool, fine. So now this region you call as a depletion region or junction, PN junction, the junction of p-type and n-type, right? Now, what if I apply a supply across this? I apply a potential to this. How do I apply the potential? The n-type has been connected to positive and p-type has been connected to negative. Right? So now suppose if there are no charge carriers here, that this region has been formed, that means there is no current flowing here. Right? If current has to flow, then the charge carrier should cross this line here. I will call it as a barrier. They should cross and then move. They should start moving here, then only it will produce current. Right? So if I increase the voltage until it exceeds this so-called junction, or I will now call it as a potential barrier, PN junction, depletion region, potential barrier. Okay, all are same. If the applied voltage exceeds the potential barrier, then there is a current flowing. If it doesn't exceed, until then it will be, current will be very minimal. Okay, it's like almost zero, negligible. If it exceeds, then current starts flowing. Now you will say the voltage at which current starts flowing as the knee voltage, K-N-E-E, knee. Why am I saying that?
It is the maximum voltage.
No.
Maximum at which current flows.
No, nothing like that. Maximum, see, I can even take it after that one, okay? So I have now plotted current here y-axis and voltage on the x-axis. I start increasing the voltage. So initially it is very less. So this is in the case of silicon, okay? And that barrier voltage is 0.7 volt ideally, okay? 0.7 volt. Now I increase the voltage, current is very, very minimal, and all of a sudden it's increased. All of a sudden the current increased when it crossed this 0.7, okay? All of a sudden it increased. Now look at the curve. It has actually, it is having a bending. This is like the bending of a knee. Your knee, if you, your leg, knee, leg as a knee, right? So if you bend the knee, how would it look like? The same way it is having a bending. So you call this as the knee of the curve. Knee of the curve. So this voltage at which the current starts increasing, you will call as knee voltage. K-N-E-E. Knee voltage. Okay. Now, oh sorry, I made a mistake of saying about the potential. Your connection was actually you have a p-type semiconductor, n-type semiconductor, in between is your junction, p-n junction or depletion region, another word, potential barrier, okay? You should connect the p-type to the positive of the supply and n-type to the negative of the supply. Yeah, tell me.
Knee voltage is breakdown voltage only, no ma'am?
No, wait, I'm coming.
Both it's cut-in voltage.
Cut-off voltage. Cut-off voltage, yes. Another name is cut-off voltage. Knee voltage or cut-off voltage. Okay. Now, this is your connection forward bias. Now, this thing actually, you, this P-type, N-type together with the junction, you call it as the P-N junction diode. Right? This forms the basic part of a semiconductor. Once I know about the different semiconductors, the next thing is the p-n junction diode. Now this is for forward biasing. Everybody understood? You increase the voltage, current will be very minimal initially. Until it exceeds the knee voltage, current will not increase. Exceeding knee voltage means the charge carriers will cross this dotted line, the barrier, and current will flow. Okay? Knee voltage or cutoff voltage. What if I connect it in the other way? That means I connect P-type to negative of supply and N-type to positive of supply. What is now happening?
Current will be zero, ma'am. Until
current
I iterate.
Not zero, current will be minimum.
The potential barrier will increase.
Potential barrier has now increased. You are having actually now more ions and less charge carriers, right? Now before that, I skipped a few points. Okay, I can show it here itself. When I connected it in forward biasing, right, from p-type I had the holes and n-type I had the electrons. I will call these as majority charge carriers. Majority charge carriers. Hole is a majority in p-type and electron is a majority in n-type. Okay. So that means what is a minority? Minority will be
electron
in p-type and hole in n-type. Okay, now two things to remember. The flow of the majority carriers is known as drifting. Majority carriers drift, minority carriers diffuse. Drift current and diffusion current. Flow of majority charge carriers, that means holes from p-type, electrons from n-type, that is it will produce a drift current. Process is known as drifting. Okay, electrons from p-type and holes from n-type, minority charge carriers, their flow is known as diffusion. It produces diffusion current, D-I-F-F-U-S-I-O-N. Okay, drift current and diffusion current. Now I have connected in reverse bias, current produces very less. But there is a problem now. That problem you would not have learned. Okay, what is that problem? Even though their number is less, even though I have only a few holes here and a few electrons here, okay? And I give like a very less voltage. Let me see if I can get this right. Okay, here it goes. So I keep on increasing the voltage. This is now in negative direction because it is reverse bias. I keep on increasing the voltage. The current produces very less. You can see it is in nano ampere, micro ampere like that, okay? Now, all of a sudden the current is increasing here. You can see that, right? And that current is going to damage the device. How does it happen? That's because a process known as depletion region increased, accepted. But you have this minority charge carriers, right? When I increase the voltage, the minority charge carrier will collide. They will gain some energy and collide with some of the ions here, which are already there. See, along with the hole, there are some ions in p-type. Said it is minority, so that means electrons here, right? And there are some ions here. There are some holes and there are some ions here, right? Some of them, they will gain some energy from that voltage as you keep on increasing the voltage. They will go and hit those ions. They will hit those ions and produce new charge carriers. Those new fellows will go and hit other ions and produce new charge carriers. Do you remember something like a chain reaction from nuclear physics? Have you heard of a chain reaction?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes? One small thing goes and hits somebody and it produces lots of the rest. And those fellows go and hit the others. Same thing is what is happening. So the minority charge carriers will hit the ions and produce more minority charge carriers. Even though their amount is less, it end up becoming, this kind of collision will end up becoming more. It will, all of a sudden, it will produce a large amount of current. See, you can see y-axis, what happened, it was in nanoampere here. All of a sudden, it increased and became milliampere. All of a sudden, the current increased and that will damage the device. The entire PN junction will be gone. So you cannot, this entire process is known as avalanche breakdown, okay? So you cannot use a PN junction diode in reverse bias for this reason. So PN junction diode works well in forward biasing, that is where you get the new voltage and other things, but reverse bias you cannot do. But you want to work in reverse bias, you need a solution for that. The solution is you increase the amount of impurity or increase the doping. A heavily doped PN junction diode is known as a Zener diode. So Zener is actually a name of a scientist. Okay, a heavily doped PN junction diode. Basically, I increase the amount of impurity atoms. I add more impurity. So then this Zener diode, it's not that it works only in reverse bias. It works in forward bias also. Forward bias, it works exactly like how PN junction does. What is it? We had this. Where was it? Oh, back. Yeah, here it is. In forward bias, for Zener diode also, you increase the voltage. Once the voltage exceeds any voltage or the barrier potential, current starts increasing. Right? Here, no issue. Zener also works in the same way. Now, when you come to reverse bias, how do you manage the situation? That is what is more important. So here I have considered this is a picture of a Zener diode. I mean, I have not put the supply. This is actually in reverse bias. So let's see what happens. I am adding more doping. I am increasing. Why do we need reverse bias? I am coming to it. Wait. I am going to increase the number of impurity atoms. Okay, so if I increase the number of impurity atoms, what will happen? I will get more ions here, right? I will end up getting more ions. So all my ions are here in the depletion region, right? I will get more ions in the depletion region, okay? And since there are more ions, some of the charge carriers, that means if I have more negative ions here, some hole from here will come and join with the negative ions. Some electrons from here will come and join with the positive ions. Okay. Basically, at the end, the width of the depletion region will be very less. So let me just repeat. I increase the doping. I increase the doping means I have more number of ions, right? And then what do? Right? Those ions, since there are more number of ions, some of those ions are being you know, nullified or neutralized. I can say neutralized. They have been neutralized by few charge carriers. Basically, the width of depletion region decreases. Width of the depletion region decreases.
Ma'am, I have a doubt, ma'am.
Let's ask.
Ma'am, how will it become nullified, ma'am?
There it is. Okay. So, I get more ions here. Correct? When I add more doping, when I increase the doping, when I have more impurity, if I have more impurity, I will get more ions here. Is it not possible?
Yeah.
Initially, I had only less ions, but I increased the impurity, so there can be more ions here. Right? Yes, so what happens is some of the charge carriers, that means holes will combine with the negative ions, a few holes will combine with some of the negative ions, and a few electrons will combine with some of the positive ions.
Yeah.
Okay, so when I added the impurity, there were many, say suppose I had 1000 here, some of them are now being reduced and I end up getting 100 ions. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, the number of ions reduced in the depletion region. So depletion region means the region where only ions are there, there are no charge carriers, right? So number of ions reduced, depletion region width reduces. Width of the depletion region reduces. If width of the depletion region reduces, what will happen to electric field? Can you tell me?
Decreases.
I have a distance decreasing, electric field will
increase.
Electric field will decrease.
Formula. Increase or decrease, whatever is the formula?
Epsilon.
Yeah, epsilon is there, correct? Can tell me the epsilon also. Electric field and distance. What is the formula?
1/4 pi epsilon naught Q1 into Q2 divided by R square.
That is electric field.
Epsilon naught into A by D.
That is capacitance.
E is equal to 1 by R.
E is equal to 1 by R, no?
Like R is the distance between the two.
R is the distance, but it is not 1 by R. It's not equal to 1 by R. It is proportional to 1 by R, correct the formula.
He is indirectly proportional to 1 by
R. Oh, formula. Yeah, somebody has written, Manoj has written, yes. E is
1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R square.
Yes, no, Q by?
R
E
square.
Is equal to V by R.
Q by X.
It's Q by R.
There are two formulas. There are two formulas. One. E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R.
Ma'am, when that is for single charge, no, ma'am.
Listen, that is for single charge. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R. So that actually comes from another version, a simplest formula which Manoj has put. E is equal to, yes, Sage has written it better. Potential by distance. V by D or dV by dr. It's actually negative dV by dr. Minus dV by dr. Or E is equal to V by distance. Inversely proportional. Electric field and distance are inversely proportional.
So ma'am, or we can take it as E is inversely proportional to 1 by R, ma'am.
E is proportional to 1 by R or E is inversely proportional to R.
Yeah, ma'am. R is inversely proportional to R. Yeah.
R or D, whichever parameter you see, it is inversely proportional to the distance. So that means distance decreases, width of the depletion region decreases, electric field
increases.
All of a sudden, everything is happening. Okay. Distance decrease, electric field increase. If electric field increase, what will happen to current? Current should increase.
Increases.
Field increases means there is more of current flow. So that is what is happening in a Zener diode. So this.
Ma'am, I have a doubt.
Yeah. Tell.
How will heavily doping help in not damaging the device?
It will not damage because the current is in a controlled manner. This doping helps for the current produced will be very less. Third, in the case of PN junction diode, that whatever that collision, avalanche, we told avalanche, right? Avalanche means like you have heard of snow avalanche, snow, ice. Everest and all people will go and they will say all of a sudden there was an avalanche, a huge amount of ice which came and killed people and all those things, right? So all of a sudden that current being produced doesn't happen in this case because now with whatever voltage you are applying, the number of ions now reduces, the depletion region width is decreasing. Whereas in PN junction diode, depletion region width was very wider, right? It was very wide. Depletion region was very wide. So your width decreases. So you have electric field increasing or the current increasing. Okay. So this is known as Zener breakdown. Even though it is known as breakdown, breakdown means it just says that all of a sudden the current increases, but this current doesn't damage the device. Okay. Now, why do you, somebody asked me, why do you need to work it in reverse bias? Why you can't be happy with forward bias? Forward bias, if you use a diode, will help in the process of only one thing, that is known as rectifying. Rectifying means if I have an AC signal, something of a sinusoidal shape.
Converting into DC.
Yeah, it will only convert into DC, a single straight signal. That happens in the forward bias. I want reverse bias because I want to use it to regulate the voltage. You can see what has happened here. I have increased the voltage and within a small region, you can see the current is increasing, right? Within a small region, if I consider, I can regulate. See, current keeps on increasing, but this width, the small portion here, that is lesser, right? So I can regulate the voltage supply. Why do you need to regulate voltage supply? Just think of this. You have a refrigerator at home. All of a sudden, there is a large supply given. Our BESCOM does all this drama, right? All of a sudden there is a large supply given. You don't have a regulator. There is nothing called as a regulator. Most of you use it. All new refrigerators have it inbuilt. If you don't have a regulator, what will happen? It will damage the entire refrigerator, right? So like that, to regulate the voltage supply, to regulate the amount of voltage, you can use a Zener diode. For that purpose, you need a Zener diode. Now, for that purpose, you need to use it in reverse bias. Okay. Now, so this is the graph which you will be generating. Basically, we increase the voltage. We do all the connection. We increase the voltage in forward bias. First, we connect in forward bias. We increase the voltage. Current increases. Or current initially it is less, and after new voltage, it increases. Then you connect in reverse bias, you increase the voltage, initially it is very less, and all of a sudden within a small range of voltage, remember that within a small range of voltage, current increases. So this is the Zener breakdown region, this is reverse bias, other one is forward bias. From the first graph, you will find V voltage. The second graph, you will find breakdown voltage. Breakdown voltage means what? The voltage at which the current start increasing.
Ma'am, I have a doubt. Ma'am, when we increase the voltage gradually or decrease the voltage gradually, Zener diode
reverse or the other way? Reverse or forward bias? Which one are you asking me? Is it in reverse bias you are asking me about Zener diode?
Yes, ma'am. Reverse bias.
Okay, tell me.
When we gradually increase the voltage, did the Zener diode hold the voltage or it gets damaged?
Gradually increase the voltage? No, it doesn't. Yes, but if you, okay, suppose, okay, if you really want to damage it.
No, I'm
asking. I'll tell you. No, even when we do in the lab, even when you watch the demo, you can listen to that. We limit it with a value of current. We don't let it exceed. We say that don't let the current exceed 20 milliamperes.
Okay.
If you give, see, anything, if you give a very high voltage, it can damage.
Okay.
And the brain, it can damage. It is possible. We regulate and we do it, right? We want to use it in that portion of voltage where we can regulate it. If I obviously say, suppose I have a 12 volt diode, 12 volt, that means if I say 12 volt zero diode, that means breakdown voltage is at 12 volt. Okay. So
okay.
If I give 30 volt, 40 volt, obviously it will go by. That is possible. But at least in 12 volt, that small range of voltage, I can use it in reverse bias. But if I consider our PN junction diode, even that value, it cannot work. It will just damage between 3 or 4 volts.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Okay. So, okay. Yes, everything comes with pros and cons. Okay. Now, is this theoretical part clear? Then I will play the video of the demonstration. And after that, at least today, we will tell you how to do. So you can do and submit maybe by Friday or something. Okay. So let me just stop the sharing of this one and get the video. Okay. Video up. Cool. So I have to press a new tab. Okay. Fine. Loading. You can see it? You can see a small, this one?
Yes,
ma'am.
Yes, a kit. Okay, so we have, in our lab, we have kits like this. The kits basically inside there are all the connections, or it's made of a PCB. PCB means it's a circuit board. Okay. Inside that, all major connections are there, lots of electrical connections are there inside. And outside, you have all knobs like this and a circuit diagram like this. So, this circuit diagram will match exactly with what is there in your lab manual. Okay. Now, I am going to play this video. So, mute yourself and listen. You should have obviously your headphones or speakers on. You should listen. Okay, listen carefully and go to play it.
So this is the kit.
That just a second. Did you hear that first sentence? Yes. Okay, cool. Fine. I'm going to play it again.
So this is the kit that we will be using for Zener diode characterization. In Zener diode, we will do the forward and reverse characteristics, that means the characteristics of the diode. We will study when it is forward biased as well as when it is reverse biased. This is the Zener diode, and if you see, there is a black mark in one at one end and there is no black mark in the other end. So this, the end where there is a black mark, that is the negative side, and this is the positive side. Okay. So this Zener diode, we will connect it here. So this kit have all these, whatever connections are shown in black, they are there inside this kit. Whatever is remaining outside, those connections we have to make with the wires. So first, if you see, there is the components that are present here in this circuit. It's a power supply, it's a regulated power supply, which goes from 0 to 20 volt. Then there is a resistor. Then there is a voltmeter. This voltmeter's display is shown here. And then there is a milliammeter whose display is here. All these things we have to connect with the Zener diode in this connection. So we'll just start doing the connections. These are the wires. So if you see here, there is no black line here or there. That means this is open. We have to connect this one to make it a closed circuit. So I will connect this two to make it close. Also, I will use another one. Yes. Then there is a voltmeter that needs to be connected. This is the display for the voltmeter. So we will connect with the display of the voltmeter. Then there is a milliammeter. only ammeters positive will go to the positive of the display, negative will go to the negative. That's all is the connection. And we have put the Zener diode in forward bias condition here. Then we'll switch on this kit. And you can see there are two knobs here. This is for coarse increase and this is for fine tuning. Means when you require very low amount of voltage increase, you have to use this one. If bigger steps you need, you have to use this knob. So in the reverse bias, in the forward bias condition, first we will take the reading. So in the forward bias condition, as we know, we have to start from 0.1 and then go till 0.5 in steps of 0.1. After 0.5, we will go in steps of 0.05 and see where exactly the current is picking up. Okay, so we will start from the beginning. So we'll just make it. So this is the voltage I'm giving. So right now, if I give, it's a very, very fine. It takes some time to stabilize. Just give it time to stabilize and see what is the value. Otherwise, you may end up taking some wrong this one. So 0.09 is almost equal to 0.1. Yeah. So the current is zero here. If I go to 0.2 or 0.3, you have to take readings for 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4 like that. I'm just going directly to 0.3 and seeing what is the value here. Again zero. Then I'll go to 0.5. You can see very, very carefully you have to give the voltage. Otherwise, this is 0.4, still it is 0. I'll increase it more. Yeah, 0.5 also 0. I'll go till 0.6 I will go. And then after that I will go in steps of 0.2 or maybe 0.55. I'll just see once how it is showing. Yes, still it is 0. Go to 6. Still 0. Then I'll go to 6 point. Slightly it started increasing. I'll go to 6.2. 0.1 is the current. 6.4. 0.2 is the current. Or not 6.4, sorry. 0.64. Then 0.66. Current is 0.4 milliampere. Because we have put this switch in milliamperes. There are two scales, one is micro and one is milliampere. So I have put it in milliamperes. So the reading is incoming is in milliamps. Then 0.68, it has gone to around 5.4 or 5.6. Then 0.7, I'm leaving it. Around 6 only, then 0.72, current is high, 7.7, 0.74, see there is a huge increase in the current, it is 15.3, then 0.76, it's 18.9. So by this time you have gone to the peak of the current, and I think till 8 or 8.2 you can take and plot the graph like this. So this is about the forward biased characteristics. I will reduce the voltage and then I will switch it off to make the connection to reverse bias. So here now what I am doing is I'm just putting it in the opposite direction. Yes. Okay. So that then this is the positive side of the battery is connected to the negative side of the diode and the negative is connected to the positive side of the diode. I'll switch it on once again. Here we have to go We will start from 1 volt, 1 volt, 2 volt, 3 volt, 4 volt, 5 volt, and then till 8 volt, 8 to 10 volt we will go. After 11 we will go in small steps. Yes, so we will use this course, yes, we will use this course tuning, and I'll directly go to 1 volt, current is 0, we will go to 3 volt directly. You have to take readings for 2, 3 all. I'm just going to 3 just for giving the demo. Still it is 0, I'll go to 5. Still it is 0, I'll go to 7. Still it is 0, I'll go to 9. Still it is 0, I'll go to 11. After 11, I'll start increasing in small steps. Yes, 11, it is 0. Then I'll go to 11.5. Because that is where we expect the breakdown to happen. Still it is 0. 11.12 I will go. See, at 11.7 only it has started increasing. 1.3 is the current, 1.3 milliampere is the current. Then I'll go to 12. 11.9 is 12.3. Then 12 I'll go, 12 volts. 29.1. So you have to take very small steps from 11 to 12 in steps of 0.02, 0.2 you can take, so that you get a proper curve which shows the breakdown of the Zener diode. Okay, so these are two small experiments that you have to do. Once you have taken all the data for various voltages, you have taken the currents, then you have to plot a graph with the x-axis having the voltage, y-axis having current, plot it for forward and reverse bias condition. Okay. Always before switching off, you have to reduce the voltages to zero and then switch off the kit. And after switching off the kit, the first thing you have to do is to disconnect all the wires and put them.